Hi, this is Graham, and I do hope everyone's having a great day. Welcome to today's video, which is my first impressions of the new Panasonic Lumix FZ1000 camera. As you can see, it's quite a big camera. It's far bigger than the predecessor, if you like, the FZ200. It's almost as big as an APS-C DSLR, and here I have a Canon 60D with just a 24 to 105mm lens. So it really compares in size to a DSLR APS-C size. It's far bigger than your traditional FZ200, and it's far bigger than a Micro Four Thirds system camera, which has a sensor which is approximately twice the size of the sensor in the FZ1000. And if you use the really compact Micro Four Thirds system, you can see just how big the FZ1000 is compared to the Olympus Pens. In terms of weight, it is quite a weighty camera as well. If we weigh these cameras in, the APS-C comes in at 1.4 kilograms. The FZ1000 is 860 grams. The FZ200, 610 grams. The Micro Four Thirds with a 14 to 140 lens, quite a heavy lens, is coming in at 883, and the little pen with a 1442 compact lens is 439. So on a day shoot, carrying the FZ1000 around, you will notice you've got a heavier camera around your neck. When you've been used to walking around with the FZ200, a couple of hours carrying the FZ1000 and you know you've got a camera around your neck. Not quite as bad as carrying the big DSLR, but still, again, for those grab and go shots, the FZ1000 is quite a big camera. Let me clear the table and let's start talking about some of the specifics of the FZ1000, things I like about it and things I don't like about it. Let's now look at the specifics of the FZ1000 camera, and in particular for those that are thinking of upgrading from the FZ200 to this larger 1-inch type sensor. Does the 1-inch sensor give us any advantages over the 1/2-inch sensor that's in the FZ200? To understand the differences between the two types of sensor, we know that the new FZ1000 has what's called a type 1-inch sensor. The actual sensor size within the FZ1000 is 15.86 by 13.3mm, which gives a 116 square millimeter area. The sensor that's in the FZ200, the 1/2-inch sensor, measures 7.66 by 6.17mm, and that gives you a square area of 28 square millimeters. So in comparison, the FZ1000 has an area four times bigger than the FZ200. The FZ200 has 12 megapixel, where the FZ1000 has 20 megapixel. So you're getting four times the sensor area for only twice the sensor pixel count. So effectively, the photosites on the FZ1000 are twice the size of the ones on the FZ200. Therefore, there's more light gathering ability from those photosites, there'll be more noise reduction, and you've got a slightly better dynamic range. So in theory, at least, the FZ1000 should give us better noise-reduced images with slightly more dynamic range. It comes at a cost. The cost is the magnification. The crop factor of the FZ200 is about 5.6, and you get that by measuring the diagonal of the FZ200 sensor and comparing that to the diagonal of a full-frame sensor, which is 36 by 24 millimeters. And that's how you get the crop factor of 5.6. When we look at the crop factor of the FZ1000, the crop factor is about 2.7. So when we look at the native focal lengths of the lenses in these cameras, we see the focal length of the FZ200 is 4.5mm to 108mm. Use the 5.6 times crop factor and you end up with the 25 to 600mm, 35mm or full frame equivalents of this lens. Do the same calculations on the FZ1000 and its native focal length is 9.1mm to 146mm, and that gives you the 25 to 400mm taking into account the 2.7 times crop factor. The same applies with the FZ1000. With its crop factor of 2.7, we end up with a 400mm full frame equivalent lens. Now you could argue 400mm is just a little bit short for wildlife photography. And it probably is. You would then have to crop in, as you would with a full frame camera, to give you reasonable sized images to use for your prints. Fortunately, the digital zoom on this camera does give you some fantastic images, even at times two, and I'll show you some more images in a later video that I've shot with this camera using 2x digital zoom, and you can see the images are really, really excellent. Because the sensor size is slightly larger, because the photo sites are slightly larger, we do get a reduction in noise. In all my tutorials you've probably seen, I recommend you only use up to an ISO of 400 with the FZ200, as beyond that you start to see a lot more granular noise and the image starts to break down. You'll be pleased to note that in the FZ1000 you can get the equivalent picture at ISO 3200. So the camera has a lot more noise reduction than the FZ200. So it means you can use this camera in low light situations than you can with the FZ200. Fortunate for that, because the lens drops to f4 quite quickly. After about 135mm, the f2.8 lens of this camera does drop to f4. So you do need to raise that ISO slightly to enable you to use faster shutter speeds. Let's now look at the handling characteristics of this new camera. As we've seen, it's quite a large camera. With the lens head removed and the camera part up, you can see we've got the Pinocchio style lens, which extends out from the camera body. This camera has now got the zoom marked on a scale on the top of the camera, which mimics some of the other manufacturers and is a useful addition. The zoom facility you can actually now set as a step zoom rather than a continuously variable one. So that's useful in some applications. You can't use that in video mode. In video mode you've still got the variable continuous zoom setting. With the lens head attached, and I recommend you always attach the lens head to protect the camera front element of the lens against scratches and knocks. Again, I don't recommend you use any protection filters, as unless you're going to pay very silly money for filters, you'll start to get ghosting and flare and reduce the actual contrast of this lens and you lose some resolution. So I would suggest that you use the lens hood and replace the lens cap when not in use. In terms of handling the camera, it is a large camera. The grip is substantial, so it doesn't feel as though it's going to slip out of your hand. It's quite nice. And of course, you're going to cradle the lens with your left hand or right hand if you're left-handed. I've seen some reports where users have been saying with the grip of the camera, there's insufficient lens room there to allow you to rest your fingers properly, and that quite often the zoom is changing as you're taking pictures. That may be the case. I haven't noticed that myself. There is a possibility, if you've got autofocus and manual focus zoom set together, that you can be actually changing the focus point while you're using the camera. But again, only if you've got the AF plus MF option set in the menu. I tend to use the front of the camera for my handling. I don't tend to use the lens barrel. I tend to support the camera by using the lens hood. With the FZ1000 comes a different arrangement for the setup of the lens barrel. We have a switch now which enables us to have the lens ring defined as zoom, and that can be the continuously variable or step zoom, or if we are in the manual focus mode, we can switch the switch down to the lower position and we use that then to focus. With the FZ200 you have to go into the menu and change the operation of the zoom lever to be a focus operation. The top control zoom lever can be pre-programmed, as in some of the G-series cameras, to be either the zoom control, or you can actually use it for exposure value compensation. So rather than having to use a function button or a quick menu to get into exposure compensation, you can actually use the zoom lever to move you up and down the exposure value scale, and that's quite a useful feature. So you then use the zoom ring to operate your zoom, and you use the zoom lever to operate your exposure value compensation. That's quite a nice combination of actuations. If you're progressing from a manual film camera and you're used to zoom lenses, you'll find that the zoom ring on this camera lacks because it's not mechanically coupled. It's a fly-by-wire device. There's a servo system between the sensor behind the zoom ring and the actual lens zoom motor. So it isn't in any way coupled directly. So it doesn't matter how fast you turn this ring, you don't change the speed at which the zoom operates. And it's the same with focus. There's no acceleration of focus if you try to move the ring quicker. So that is one thing that you have to be aware of if you're transitioning from lenses with full manual zoom. If you're a sports photographer and like to be able to zoom to a full zoom position and back very quickly, then you're not going to be happy with the manual focus of the zoom ring. You can use the zoom lever, which has got a two-stage zoom, which is slightly faster, but again, not as fast as the traditional manual zoom. So that's something you should be aware of if you're transitioning from a different lens system. There again, the actual focus ring is very slow to react in some instances, especially in manual focus, where you need to find that pinpoint operation. You can actually go through the point of focus and back, and you tend to be oscillating quite a bit to find the exact point because there's a certain amount of lag and dead zone on this metering scale. Brand new feature on this camera is an OLED EVF, and that's 2.36 megapixel display. It's not field sequential, as the same as in the FZ200, so you don't see these color bands if you blink quickly. You can change the field rate from 30 frames per second to 60 frames per second if you wanted a faster refresh rate. The camera supports Wi-Fi and NFC connectivity, but one disappointment I had with the camera, I expected to find the NFC either on the side of the camera or up on the flash head. But unfortunately, NFC connectivity is done by the chip, which is on the bottom of the camera. So if you've got this camera mounted on a tripod, you can't get your camera to connect to it. You'd have to rely on the previous connection history to set up your connection. So if it was the first time you'd used NFC and you'd mounted on a tripod, you've got to disassemble this to get your camera to communicate via the NFC area on the camera. So that was a bit of a disappointment. The actual camera itself, I have come to love it. It was quite a severe change from the menuing system and the operation from the FZ200, and initially I had some frustrations with the camera not being able to go to functions that I've been able to drop on very, very quickly with the FZ200 just through practice. I'll give you one example of that, and that is this excellent focus button on the side of the FZ200. So when you're in manual focus mode and you wanted to get the camera very quickly to that manual focus point, you press the focus button and the camera would be forced into an autofocus mode and got you very close to within the manual focus point you wanted. With this camera, there's no direct button that you can use. You've got to program one of the function buttons to do that. And that took me a while to customize and find out how to operate it. So I was getting frustrated that when I was in manual focus mode, I was having to use the manual focus ring to get me to focus, where normally I could just press one button and get me to that point of focus. I've now sorted that out, and that's not an issue for me now. Another upgrade to this camera is in the flash unit. The flash unit now will wirelessly control by the flashlight itself groups of flashes on a TTL exposure mode. So this now will control wireless flashes of the Panasonic FL360L group or the FL580L. So you can set up various groups as you can with some of the more modern DSLRs. You can have group A, group B, group C, and wirelessly control them from this camera. Also has a hot shoe you can actually mount your camera or use a TTL extension lead if you wanted to use a TTL compatible flash rather than using wireless flash. The actual flash unit itself has also got the provision for manual control of the flash power. So we can have it from full power to 1/128th of a power. So that's ideal if you're doing close-up, and with a small flash diffuser, you can vary the power of the flash output. I'm not going to go into all the technical specifications of this camera. They're freely available on other review sites, so I'm not going to go through any of the technical specs. I'm just going to give you the headlines that I think are the most important for an upgrade from the FZ200, or if you're thinking of transitioning to this new type 1-inch sensor. The camera has now the new 5-axis stabilization. So a 5-axis stabilization not only corrects for pitch and roll, it also connects for raw, but it also connects for front and back. So you've got the 5-axis stabilization, which in some respects should give you a better image stabilization for things like video. I have had 2 or 3 images in the hundreds that I've taken where there's been an out of focus effect from one side of the frame to the other. Only on a few images, but I can only assume it's the way that the lens has been caught off guard, if you like, with the 5-axis stabilization. The shot before it and the shot after it were perfectly focused from side to side, but the one in between where I might have just moved the camera slightly, there was a very noticeable difference between the left and right sides of the frame. And I'll try and put one of those at the end of this video so you can see the effect. The camera has an electronic shutter and a mechanical shutter, and you can choose either, or you can leave the camera to decide. It now supports exposures up to 60 seconds, or if you're using a remote release, you can actually use this for bulb exposure now. So those star shots you wanted, or those firework displays where you wanted to keep the aperture open but just shield the lens, you can now use the remote shutter with a lock on to put you in the bulb mode. Electronic shutter allows you to use shutter speeds from 1 second up to a blistering 1/16,000th of a second in the electronic shutter mode. In the manual shutter mode, we are talking 60 seconds down to 1/4,000th of a second. The AF speed is quite fast and point to point is very quick. There is a new mode that's been introduced, and that is the autofocus precision. It's one step further than the spot focus that we have with the FZ200. It uses a smaller pixel area, a pixel magnifier, to actually see where the area is you are focusing on. It does rely on contrast detection to actually find this focus point. And I had a couple of images where I just could not get the camera to focus using that method. I think the subject was quite bland in tone, so the camera couldn't differentiate the areas of contrast to be able to set that focus point. And in fact, on a couple of occasions where I've been using area focus, I just could not get the camera to focus quickly on the area that I had set up in the viewfinder. I had to point the camera to a larger area to get that rough area, and then bring the camera back to that point. So that's something I need to look at in terms of AF speed and the area defined for getting that focus point quickly. The autofocus system uses now 49 area points compared to 23 of the FZ200. And you can actually define how you want those focus areas to be grouped together. There is a free define area, and it allows you to set each one of those 49 area points to be either on or off. So it's either using or not using that area for focus acquisition. So you might have some harebrained idea of where you want your focus points to be defined. You can set those up now in this 49 area mode. So you can actually define just a central point, or a central point with one to the left and one to the right if you're using birds in flight type thing. And you can actually set up a band in the middle, 3 or 4 pixels wide, just along the center for sort of bird in flight photography as well. I haven't actually been out and tried to capture some birds in flight yet with this. The weather's been too bad, but as soon as I get the opportunity, I'll be out there and testing it in this mode. The camera's got this DFD new focusing system, which is supposed to evaluate the amount of autofocus by looking at the autofocus pattern in the defocused area of the image. And then it can work out where it's got to drive the lens to get that quickly into focus. I haven't noticed any difference in terms of focus speed or whether it's any accurate. I haven't been using the camera long enough to determine that yet. The theory sounds right, but I'm not sure it transfers into practicality. Another new feature of the camera is the ability to create multiple exposures within the camera. So you don't have to do this in Photoshop anymore, you can do it in camera, and the camera's smart enough to allow you to be able to set the way the exposures work so it can actually build up to the final overall intensity by evaluating the densities of the previous image. So you can actually do your multiple overlays and get the correct exposure in camera. Additionally, for video shooters are 2 new modes in the photo styles. One is the Cine-like D, which is a gamma curve, and the other one is the Cine-like V, which is contrast based. So you can actually change the way the camera will record the scene. If you're using Cine-like D, you can do your own grading in your post-production. If you're using Cine-like V, it's just the standard, almost vibrant colours out of the camera directly. So if you're a videographer, the Cinelite D is probably the best photo star to use, as you can grade the image to how you like it in your post-processing. We have now in-camera RAW processing, and it gives you the full range of options for processing RAW in-camera to produce your own JPEGs. So rather than having to go to Photoshop or to Lightroom or to SilkyPix, you can actually post-process your image in the camera and work out just exactly how you want your image to appear before it leaves the camera. So that's a useful addition, and it means that you can get the best possible shots from the camera before you leave location. The actual photo styles in the camera now have a range of plus or minus 5, which is a step up from the plus or minus 2 on the FZ200. So it does mean you can make larger changes with the photo styles. In terms of using those photo styles, the shots that I showed you in my initial video, which was just some standard images from the camera, were all shot with the default standard photo style settings, all 0. In subsequent tests, and I'll show you those in a later video, I've actually been able to use plus 5 on the sharpening scale without any artifacts appearing in JPEGs, no halo around the bright contrast of tree branches and things like that. So it does look as though you can push the sharpness level slightly away from the 0, and in fact all the way up to 5 in some instances. I'll be doing more tests on those photo styles to try and establish what would be a sensible working arrangement for my type of photography. Remember, photo styles are personal issues, and some people like to change them, other ones leave them all at minus 5 so they can post-process the way that they would like to. If you're going to do that amount of post-processing, you might as well shoot RAW and either use the in-camera JPEG processing or use an external RAW processing system. In addition to being able to change saturation and contrast in the photo styles, is a new curve adjustment tool called Highlight and Shadow. You can actually program the way highlights and shadows will work. So if you want to retain highlights, you can boost the shadows, or you can change the contrast to a higher contrast or lower contrast by using presets. And you can actually save those presets into C1, C2 or C3 profiles. So if you've got particular setup needs, you can actually store them in the presets of the camera and then recall them at an instant when you need to use them. Camera's now got a nice HDR mode in camera, and you can actually set the HDR range between plus or minus 1 to plus or minus 3 increments. So you can take 3 exposures and it will combine them into one single HDR image based on whether you've set plus or minus 1 or plus or minus 2 or plus or minus 3 values. With focus bracketing, it's now changed to 3, 5 or 7 increments, so it gives us a more professional range of exposures to work with. And it's the same with the exposure value compensation. We've now got a range of plus or minus 5 EV compared to minus and plus 3 EV on the FZ200. We're still restricted to plus or minus 3 in the video mode. Talking of the video modes, you'll find that the 25 to 400, and again I'm talking 35mm equivalent, change when you shoot video. For example, when you shoot MP4 HD video, you'll find that the 25mm end becomes 28 and the maximum zoom is 392mm. So there's a slight reduction in the range of the camera when you're shooting in HD video. If you're shooting 4K video, then we lose the 25mm end, that becomes 37mm, but our telephoto end goes from 400 up to 596, and that's not using any digital zoom, that's just using the crop of the sensor. So if you're shooting 4K video in the camera, the range becomes 37mm to 596. So with the ability to pull an 8 megapixel still from your 4K video, it should create some opportunities for wildlife photographers to take video and then subtract a still from that 4K video. In talking 4K video, I've shot some 4K with this camera. I can't display it on my television, only from down-resing the HDMI output from the camera to 1080p to watch on a television. I have tried to process the 4K in a number of my editing programs, and there's only been the Sony Vegas that I've managed to been able to edit 4K on. I know there are other programs that are available to edit 4K, and I'll be trying those out in the near future. You can actually do this subtraction of stills from the PhotoFun Studio that comes with the camera. Unfortunately, Photophone Studio is only for PC Windows users. There's no equivalent in the Mac world at the moment. So with Photophone Studio, you can import the 4K video, you can downscale it to 1080p, and then you've got a MOV file which you can use in any other application to edit at 1080p. So some advantage in 4K and some disadvantages dependent on which side of the scale you like to see your zoom. In terms of 4K video, you will find that you need to use the SDXC cards, so you'll need the higher capacity cards. This thing consumes data at the rate of about 150 gigabytes per hour. So with a 64 gig card, you're only going to get 30 minutes of recording time in 4K mode. You need to use the SDXC, and Panasonic say use the U3 rating for this card. I've actually used U1 without any problems. And in fact, in the literature, they're saying now for the MP4 and AVCHD, a class 4 card sufficient, where previously they stated class 6 or class 10 for the MP4. If you're an FZ200 user and have been using teleconverters with the LA7 extension tube, you're not going to like this section, because the FZ1000 doesn't support the facility to put a lens extension tube on. There's no threads on the inside of the lens barrel to enable you to use a extension tube and your teleconverter lens if you wanted to get a longer reach. I've prototyped an idea which will allow me to use the teleconverter lens onto this lens, which will be an aftermarket device. It'll need to be supported by the tripod mount to allow the tube to fit over the outside diameter of the lens to support the weight of the teleconverter lens. I've been bringing some news of that in a couple of weeks' time when I've actually machined something up which will actually work on this camera. You can use the Raynox lenses, as they do have the 52mm to 67mm adjustment facility, so they will fit on the lens, allowing you to use them for your macro photography. But beware, you need to zoom to something like 200mm to allow you to get through the vignetting caused by these small 43mm Raynox lenses. You can of course use larger diameter achromat lenses if you can find them to fit 67mm, which this lens has. The other thing you should be aware of is the optical image stabilization circuit of this camera is quite noisy. Even with it turned off, the camera has to support that lens which does the 5-axis stabilization in the center of the optical axis, so it needs to be powered continuously. And it's always hunting, and it sounds like a pit of vipers. It's quite noticeable in a very quiet environment. I'm just going to show you a video clip now that I took of a candle flame, and you can hear the optical image stabilization hissing away even though I've got it on a tripod and turned off. You can also, with the internal microphones, pick up all the handling noise of the camera. You'll pick up the zoom motor, you'll pick up the clicking of many buttons. So if you want to be recording video with more professional audio quality, you're of course going to use the external microphone socket and an external microphone to get you the best possible audio. In terms of audio, the camera does support manual level control, so that's a good feature, but it doesn't have audio monitoring like the GH4 or the GH3. You don't have a headphone jack. I guess that's just the way Panasonic have pitched this camera. It's just one step down from the serious amateur stroke lower end professional with the GH3, GH4 cameras. So those are things to be aware of with the camera: the fact that you can't use the teleconverter lenses with this camera, the fact the optical image stabilization hisses around and you can hear it, so if you're in a very quiet environment you will hear that optical image stabilization, and the fact that you do need to use external microphones to record good quality audio rather than relying on the internal microphones, which are going to pick all the ambient sounds up, not only within the camera but also the handling noise as well. Well, that just about sums up the changes from the FZ200 up to the FZ1000. In terms of ease of use, I found the camera okay to use. I have no complaints about it at the moment. Image quality is superb. Even shots up to ISO 1600, it's difficult to actually criticize. I know there have been some complaints already on some of the review sites about image quality. And honestly, I don't know where people are getting these image quality problems from. Whether it's a lack of experience in actually using cameras, I do not know. A camera of this type, you're not going to be using the IA mode. You're not going to buy a camera with all this functionality and leave it in the fully auto mode. The camera is just asking you to use the manual modes and the semi-automatic modes to give you some opportunities to create better pictures by using things like the photo styles, using things like the highlight and shadow control, and being able to fine-tune it for your type of photography. If you want to leave it to IA, you might as well buy yourself an FZ200 and enjoy the quality that this camera will produce in the IA mode as well. So until my next video, well, I'll be going through some more advanced features that I found with this camera which set it apart from the FZ200. I'll leave you with some final images that I've shot with the camera just to give you an idea of the range that this camera will accommodate. So until the next video, thanks very much for watching, take care and goodbye for now.